Hello, perfume lovers. Today we have very special content, hope you like it. 11 Secrets of Perfumers. Perfumers are a rare breed. These half-artist, half-scientist hybrids memorize the smells of hundreds of ingredients and spend decades honing their craft, which might explain why there are reportedly more astronauts than perfumers in the world. For many, the job isn't merely about peddling bottles of sweet-smelling stuff to consumers, the goal is to convey an emotion, create a beautiful moment, or jog a childhood memory. To find out what it takes to create top-notch fragrances. 1. Perfumers can identify hundreds of ingredients by smell alone. Master perfumers are sometimes called a nez, the French word for nose, for good reason. They commit hundreds of scents to memory and can distinguish between ingredients that would smell identical to the untrained nose. Many perfumers can also tell an essential oil from a synthetic material, which is no small feat. You're talking maybe 200 essential oils and about 1500 synthetic materials. The trick is to associate each smell with a distinct memory. The more experiences you have in your life, the more memories you create, and that's really how you remember these raw materials when you first start studying, because it reminds you of your grandmother or a flower shop or a bakery or a certain gum. The link between smell and memory has actually been proven by science. One 2018 study by neurobiologists at the University of Toronto revealed that the brain not only stores information about certain scents but also memories of when and where you first encountered them. 2. Having a good sense of smell isn't enough to make a good perfumer. Many aspiring perfumers mistakenly believe that a good nose will get them far. That's like saying that if you have 20/20 vision you're the next Picasso. A keen nose is very useful, but at the end of the day, I have met perfumers who were extremely talented who didn't smell anything more sharply than anybody else. They just had the capacity to think in a different way about what they were doing with scent and combining it in unique and interesting ways. More important than a good sense of smell is creativity, a natural talent for recognizing scents that work well together, and the dedication to building a very particular base of knowledge and skill. 3. Frances Gavaudan Perfumery School is the goal for many would-be to perfumers. Gavaudan Perfumery School in France. Founded in 1946, it only accepts one or two promising students each year out of thousands of applicants, and sometimes none at all, if that year's crop of candidates don't live up to the school's high standards. Former director Jean Guichard has said he hand-selected students based on their personality, talent, and motivations. The perfumer should be a mixture between a scientist and a poet, Guichard told, "When I meet people, I know if they have a talent or not. I don't want to have people who say, I'm going to be a perfumer because they make a lot of money. That doesn't interest me at all." The now four-year Gavaudan program is rigorous. First, students have to memorize about 1500 raw materials. Next, they learn how to build accords, which are the fragrance notes, like rose or jasmine, that form the heart of a perfume. They move on to perfume schemas, the skeleton of a fine fragrance, which contains 10 to 12 materials, and also learn about the culture and history of perfume. It takes a long time to learn all of that, and that's what you're doing all day from 9 a.m. till 4 p.m. It's intense. If and when they graduate, they'll have a job waiting for them at the Gavaudan Fragrance Company, which is where they'll learn how to make perfumes under the guidance of a seasoned professional. 4. Perfume school isn't the only way to break into the industry. 99.9% of aspiring perfumers would benefit from attending a perfume school. However, I personally did things a little differently and learned the fundamentals of perfume making. It's even less common for a perfumer to be self-taught, but it's not impossible. Information about natural materials, fragrance books from the early 1900s, before synthetic materials started to saturate the market. Now, using hundreds of natural ingredients, no synthetics, to create unique fragrances. All of the perfumers agreed that this career is a continuous learning process. 5. Not all perfumers work with fine fragrances. The fragrance is used in many different ways, some of which we encounter on a daily basis without realizing it. Some perfumers specialize in creating scents for industrial application, which could include anything from children's toys to paint to fabric. In the case of toilet bowl cleaners, cat litter, and asphalt, the goal is not necessarily to create a pleasant aroma, instead, the challenge is to mask an unpleasant one. However, many of the perfumers working on the industrial side have scientific backgrounds and tend to work for a chemical company rather than a perfume label. 6. Some of the materials perfumers work with are hazardous. Some undiluted ingredients, such as cinnamon, can cause severe chemical burns if they get on one's skin. The perfumer wears gloves and goggles while blending materials and says some ingredients in his studio come with a "Do not open without authorization" label attached. He says, "We have a protocol here that if anything new comes in, it's opened in specific parts of the building or even sometimes outside on the terrace so that we don't have an accident where it's like, oops, I just spilled one single drop of aldehyde, an organic compound, and now the entire building is uninhabitable, although next week it will smell like a ginger ale." 7. They want you to know your aromatherapy lotion might not be made of rose, jasmine, or whatever the bottle claims it contains. Labels can be deceptive. If you're buying an aromatherapy lotion or shower gel that claims to have rose, sandalwood, or jasmine in it but costs $15, that's a red flag. These ingredients can cost many thousands of dollars per pound. It's far more likely that cheaper products contain just a drop or two of the natural oils advertised, for the sake of being able to list them on the label, plus a host of synthetic ingredients that mimic the smell. 8. They're not always working on fragrances they like. Marketing is a huge part of the cost of the perfume, especially on the higher end. The perfume industry spent around $800 million on marketing in 2016, according to Bloomberg. 90% of the time, the cost of the juice in that bottle is fractional. Marketing demands are also one reason why perfumers don't always get to follow their nose and their creativity. Most perfumers who work at large houses are not so happy with their job all the time. For every fine fragrance they get to work on, they're compelled to work on a ton of crap fragrances as well. Much of it is entirely dependent on the whim of the marketing company. Companies are also more risk-averse. Perfumes themselves now aren't always built to last. It used to be that a classic was considered to last for 20 years, so your Chanel 5 and things of that nature, it's very rare to have a perfume that stays around for even 10 years. 9. The smell of puppies is impossible to replicate, but perfumers are trying. Fragrances imitating some scents are harder to capture than others. That's because the aroma chemicals needed to replicate certain smells haven't been created yet. This can be said of gasoline, champagne and certain wines, and some animal smells. Particularly with puppies and kittens, the molecules needed to accurately reproduce those smells don't exist in the perfumer's palate. For instance, his roast beef fragrance doesn't contain roast beef or anything like it, but it does contain notes of parsley and black pepper. That scent in particular, and a few others like it, aren't meant to be worn on the body. Some of the fragrances are more like modern-day smelling salts, where the goal is to revive you, in a sense, by relieving stress. All you have to do is open the bottle, breathe in, and your system will automatically reset to calm, he says. 10. Perfumers sometimes work with whale poop. Perfume makers work with some unusual ingredients, and ambergris is certainly at the top of the list. This rock-like material comes from the excrement of sperm whales and occasionally washes up onshore. Curious scents. To convert the solid mass of crushed-up squid and cuttlefish bits into an aromatic oil, must mash it up with a mortar and pestle, then add alcohol, heat it, and let it age. So what does it smell like in liquid form? Heaven. It's just ambery and shimmery. It's a miracle of transformation. Besides, Herman Melville mentioned it in Moby Dick and it used to be a 17th century ice cream flavor, so you know it has to be good. 11. They keep wool near pay to combat nose fatigue. Wool is the olfactory equivalent of eating sorbet in between courses. If you're smelling the same scent for a prolonged period of time or sniffing too many perfumes in a row, your odor receptors will habituate and stop sending those signals to your brain. This is officially called olfactory fatigue, and it explains why you might stop noticing a smell after a couple of minutes. If you smell a lot of scented materials, a lot of times your nose will just kind of conk out. Keep some wool nearby to help reset the sense of smell, and three big whiffs do the trick. So why does this work? A theory, the lanolin in wool absorbs and neutralizes odors, giving the brain a rest from sensory overload. As for those coffee beans you might see in some perfume shops? Those definitely don't work. Oh, perfumers, amazing people, half artists, half scientists. I wish you have a very good time watching this video and wish to enjoy it. For coming episode, have a beautiful day.